I welcome everyone to the video, and more importantly, welcome everyone to the mood of repentance, which is prepare to hear such great news that you really need to be very in a subdued, calm, subdued, humble mood to withstand the shock of the great good news. What's important is that the mood of repentance spreads throughout the land. That's what's really important. Otherwise, we will not be able to withstand the great good news, which we have to hear the good news. Everyone does. At some point, everybody has to hear, assimilate, and accept the fantastic great good news. That happiness doesn't need to be perceived. It can't be perceived, and it doesn't need to be perceived. We don't need to perceive happiness. We just need to experience it. Freedom, same thing. We don't need to perceive freedom. We simply experience it. We don't need to perceive oneness. We simply experience it. In fact, we don't need perception at all. We don't need a body at all. Body's the perceiver, as it were. Symbol of perception. We don't need to do anything to be happy. No effort is required. No trying is required. No progress is required. Oneness doesn't need our progress. Doesn't need progress to be one. Nothing is required of us. That's the great good news. Now, it's very important to be subdued in this mood of repentance to hear this information. Very important. To prevent your mind from racing is super important. For sure, I have so much experience in this where you get a breakthrough, you see something, you realize, oh my gosh, it's a lot easier than I thought. And then the mind starts racing. Oh, I can do this, I can do that, I can do this. And you know, it's like terrible. And then you get frightened of the good news. Whereas when you accept the mood of repentance, very subdued, not submissive to anyone or anything, very subdued, purposefully, consciously subdued. Not on drugs subdued. You do it with your own will and determination. Very humble. Not trying to innovate. Not trying to shift into entrepreneurial mode. Not trying to do anything. Nobody needs to do anything. Happiness is already here. Nothing needs to be achieved whatsoever. Nothing needs to be achieved. You cannot achieve happiness. You can only be happiness. So it's super important to be in this subdued condition, very, very much in this mood of repentance, of, you know, I have this severe continuity problem, and when I hear the great good news, I might start activating my thinking, like, oh, what can I do, what can I do? I need to do something about this, I need to do something. Whereas the realization is I don't need to do anything to be happy. In fact, the attempt to be happy is what blocks it, is what blocks our experiencing of it. Happiness is the natural state, is the natural experience of oneness, of freedom. Our true identity is happiness. There's nothing we need to do to be happy. So, what's super important is all important is this mood of repentance spread throughout the land, spread throughout the world. And there should be a practice every day. People should practice it several times a day, for sure. Is there should be everyone stop what they're doing and practice this mood of repentance and saying, and turn towards the great good news and saying, really, I bring to mind that I don't need to do anything to be happy. Happiness does not need to be achieved. Happiness does not need to be sustained. It does not need to be perceived at all. And in fact, we cannot perceive it. That's what blinds us to it. The attempt to perceive reality is what blinds us to it. The attempt to achieve reality is what blinds us to it. And there has to be a practicing throughout the land of this mood of repentance. This is what's missing from the world. This is what's missing. And it's in this condition that you can withstand the great good news, hearing the good news. The good news is so wonderful. It is so fantastic that we don't realize how fantastic it is because we can't tolerate it, because we think once we hear good news, we need to do something about it. Build a city, you know, something like that. We have to symbolize it. We have to be able to perceive it. So we say, oh, yeah, I need a perceptual symbol of the good news that I, of formlessness. I need to put form on, I need to put formlessness into form, we think. We're in this active achievement, do, you know, try, process, a progress mode, which is the problem. That's the problem. So we have to practice getting out of that mode on a regular basis. Islam has their tradition of what, 5 times a day or something, everyone stops their work and prays towards Mecca. This is in its intent is the basic idea of stopping what you're doing, your business, your go-go-go-ness, all that, and getting into a subdued state of mind is a very good practice, actually. Is a very good practice. I'm just telling it like it is. I'm not advocating anything one way or the other. But that is a very good practice to stop what you're doing. To stop what you're doing. And Jesus recommends every hour to take 5 minutes to stop what you're doing and turn towards this, you know, mood of repentance. Now, I don't do that every hour. I don't. I found myself looking at my watch constantly. It's driving me crazy. I should have like an hour reminder on my watch, but maybe I do. I don't know. There's one way you can use your smartphones properly, is have it chime on the hour and then say, okay, I'm just going to stop trying to achieve anything and just practice the mood of repentance, very subdued. Let me just go into the subdued, calm, subdued, non-thinking, non-attaining, non-progress, non-trying state of mind. And what this does is it generates a tolerance for great good news. Because the good news is so great, we don't understand it, how great it is. It's only those who have practiced the mood of repentance that can withstand the great good news. Because the news is so great, if we're not in this subdued condition, we're going to go bonkers. It's just like, we're just going to just be raving, you know, and running down the street and just hallelujah, you know, just like over the moon, you know, over the moon. And then we kind of get worried, like, well, people think I'm a lunatic or something. How can anyone receive such great good news, right? See, here's the thing. The good news is so incredibly great that the world doesn't believe it. So if somebody is acting out this good news, the world's going to block them up and put them in a straitjacket, thinking, you know, there couldn't be any cause for such great celebration. There couldn't possibly be. But there is. It's such good news that it's stunning good news. So we don't want to be immobilized by the good news. So someone take the good news and just sit there immobilized by it, transfixed and immobilized. And people think, oh my God, they've gone into a psychotic trance, a psychotic situation. Let's get them on meds immediately. Let's help them out. You know, they need to learn how to progress and try and succeed and perceive and evolve their perception and, you know, all this stuff. When they realize, no, I don't need to do any of that. And that, in fact, that's what's blocking the awareness of reality. So we don't want to be transfixed by immobilized, and we don't want to be acting outright, just a, you know, head over heels celebration. So we want to be able to keep our stride in the world. At the same time, realize the great good news. This is all important. So, as a culture, we've dropped the ball, for sure. We've dropped the ball. Going to church once a week is not the answer. It's not the answer. You have to do it on a daily basis. Whatever your discipline is to enter the mood of repentance, it has to be done on a daily basis, for sure. For sure. Now, some people read their holy scriptures like once a day, morning and evening, prayer time, you know, whatever it is, where you turn away from the endeavor, the effort, the seeking to find, the seeking to grow, to progress, to become better at, to, you know, all of this whole complex of the ego. This is all ego. And tune in to the fact we already, that experiencing happiness doesn't require any effort whatsoever. And happiness cannot be attained or perceived or reached or found. It's by giving up the effort to find it that we experience it. So this is what's meant by religious culture. And the fact is that it's absolutely essential for there to live in a religious culture. It means turning away regularly from worldly endeavor to be in this subdued mood of repentance, saying, I have a severe continuity problem, I understand that, and it takes a while for this to sink in, but I need to, it, it'll shock me and stun me when I see this. I say, wow, that's so stunning. I'm so stunned that I don't need to be stunned. You know, it's like that. See, this condition we're in now is a stunned condition of the world, very stunned. Like comatose, and then you realize, hey, I don't have to be comatose. Well, that in itself is a shocking realization. It's a stunning realization. So we have to do this. So it's inescapable, unavoidable, that we will have to, everyone has to discipline themselves this way eventually. And the whole idea of a religious culture is that's what people do. You don't even have to have a formal religion, one religion, right? No, you don't have to have it formalized necessarily. It's, everyone can do it their own way if they want to. What's important is that it is done. If you want to, you know, be saved from your stunned, severely stunned comatose condition, and everyone has to awaken from it. There's no choice. Identity is formless. We have no choice but to. And formlessness cannot be perceived. Oneness cannot be perceived. Cannot be perceived. There is no viewpoint outside of oneness to perceive it. So the world, especially Western culture, is they've gotten on the wrong page. And they're celebrating being on the wrong page, actually. It's kind of like, you know, you get the juvenile delinquent, you know, boasting about their delinquency kind of thing is where we're at. Not a good situation. Now, in a religious culture, there are various prescriptions, rules that to help people turn to this mood of repentance, which again is the shock absorber for great good news. It's the shock absorber that we need. It's not an end in itself, no. What those rules and regulations do is they help us in our endeavor to turn to the mood of repentance on a regular basis. That's all they're there for. And also they help us receive the great good news and help us so that we don't go all mental about it and start, think, and activate. Don't let it activate your thinking about, wow, I can do this and this and this and this and this, and I'm gonna, you know, help us in that regard. So how do we keep that entrepreneurial thinking, activating all this, you know, out of control thinking? How do we keep that subdued? You know, it's very important. And I've always said, don't be buzzed on any sort of drug, because you can control your thinking if you're not high on something, whenever drug's not in control. You absolutely can. You can make a determined effort saying, no value into anything else. I'm going to stay. You can keep yourself pretty much focused on being subdued. It's an effort, sure. But if you're all flying high on something, then the wheels come off. So you may want to run out and tell people about the great good news. So my God, I got to tell everybody. You know, how am I going to do that? I got to just send out. Wow, I got to send out messages. I got to do this. Da, 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 da. You know, and before you know it, you know, you're in achievement mode. So sooner or later, we all will find ourselves in a religious culture. Now, this world is trending away from that, for sure. Doing their very best to avoid it. And the secular humanist leadership of the planet is... Their purpose is to lead us away from this, actually. That's their goal. They want their intellect to be the great good news, you see. They're egomaniacs, actually. The world is being governed by egomaniacs. They want their intellectual pronouncements to be the great good news. But I tell you, the great good news is so fantastic. And it is that your intellect doesn't have to do anything. You do not have to understand happiness. Do not have to perceive it. Perceiving means understanding. Don't have to perceive it. Doesn't have to be perceived. Doesn't have to be understood. Oneness doesn't have to be understood. What is there to understand it? What is there about oneness that needs to understand oneness? Doesn't understanding not required? So, the world is being led astray by egomaniacs who are not humble, who are not truly humble, who are all about themselves, about their intellect, about their accomplishments, about how clever they are, how progressive they are, you know, how into, you know, entrepreneurial they are, how great they are at fixing things of ideals and ideas, and what can we do, and how can we do this, this, and that, and what needs to be changed here and there, and all this. Nothing needs to be changed in order for happiness. We don't need to change anything to see happiness, because we don't need to see happiness. So happiness is already the case. There's only happiness, actually. There's only freedom. Is not a good situation for anyone. again, they want the world, people, to view them as their source of happiness, of their cleverness, with words and speechifying and whatever, to be seen that they are the ones who are, should be followed and worshipped, and they're the source of your happiness. They're the source of your good news. That's what they want. To distract you from truth. It's an ego trip. So when the world is ego tripping, that's not a good thing. And it's really ego tripping now. The body doesn't need to do anything. The body is the perceiver, so to speak. The perceiver, trying to perceive oneness. Oneness can't be perceived. The body is useless. The intellect is useless. The world is useless. See, the world is truly, absolutely useless. The world is the generator of perception. This is supposed, the consciousness of trying to perceive oneness. Oneness cannot be perceived. So what's going to happen? Well, disaster is going to happen, I'm sure. Those who want to follow these egomaniacs, thinking that their happiness is coming from their achievements and from them, are going to, you know, run into disaster. And then maybe that will chase them enough to say, wow, that's not the answer. So, we stay in the mood of repentance as much as possible, realizing we don't have to get it. Get it means perceive it. We don't have to perceive oneness. Oneness doesn't require perception. Happiness doesn't require perception. Happiness does not require that it be perceived to be happiness. So we can be happy, unconditionally happy right now. In fact, see unconditional happiness everywhere, right now. There is no requirement that it be perceived. This is all a fantasy requirement that we're engaged in. We've made it up. We say, no, in order to be happy, we have to do all this stuff. We have to build a world, build a planet, build a civilization, build a universe. We have to have all these bodies. We have to generate evolution. That's all a fantasy. None of that is necessary. In fact, it's all totally beside the point, completely useless, unnecessary, and totally useless. Once we can absorb this is fantastic news. It means we're free right this instant. Free to be happy this very instant. What is useless is already useless. So there's nothing that we need to do. We don't need to discard anything. It's always been useless. It's like we have this fan turning in the room, you know, to cool the room down. And then we realize that we don't need to cool the room down. The room's already cool. So we can turn off the fan. The fan just keeps going around, or we don't even have to turn it off. It's okay. It's useless. It's useless. It's not needed at all. So just because we realize this is the world's useless, we don't necessarily have to discard it. And you know, if something's useless, for instance, here's this empty can. Diet A&W root beer. Well, you know, this can is empty, it's useless, but I don't have to crush it and smash it and, you know, I can just put it somewhere here and let it sit here for a while. It's you know, what's useful is what's in the glass, you see. So just because we see that the world is useless, bodies are useless, it doesn't mean we have to grind them into dust. That's useless too. Now, will the world get religion? And I mean, true ecumenical religion is this mood of repentance. Will that spread throughout the world at this time? I don't know. I have my doubts at this point. Anyone that does that, be labeled a kook, a cult, you know, just the most incredible, rancid type of vilification of that, because people have been brainwashed into thinking happiness comes from following the leader. The smart leader, you see, the leader that's going to bring accomplishment and help us perceive happiness. And so they think, you know, to not do that means failure for them. So they've got the cart so far in front of the horse that, you know, wow, it's a big undertaking to get it the right way, the horse in front of the cart, a big, huge undertaking. So it doesn't seem likely at all. The media, the newspapers, the internet sites, the television, the radio, all the media, you know, everyone is so unrepentant. Obviously unrepentant. It's completely obviously unrepentant. They don't realize it because they don't even know what repentance is. It's like the land of the blind. Nobody knows they're blind because nobody there can see. So, you know, when someone can see, then everybody says, hey, they're making the one who can see is making all us feel blind. That's not right. We can feel good about ourselves by getting rid of the one that can see, and then we won't feel uncomfortable about our blindness. This is that kind of mood. That's not a good mood. So I don't know if there's some big revival planned or something. I always hope there would be, because other than that, what do? Relocation? I don't know if it's possible to even really get any momentum going in this world as far as dropping momentum. The momentum is we need to drop momentum towards dropping momentum. There is no momentum towards happiness. It's the momentum, the belief in momentum is what is blocking us. Because momentum, what momentum can oneness have? Towards what? So the momentum is momentum towards perceiving oneness, which is impossible. So actually there is no momentum because everything's useless. How can there be momentum? But we presume there's momentum. And so the world has all this presumed momentum built up. And what we have to do is change that to momentum towards dropping momentum, to realizing that we don't need any momentum to be what we are. Oneness doesn't need any momentum to be oneness. But the world, it lives, runs on momentum. The presumption of momentum. There is no momentum taking place whatsoever. It's all, moment by moment, completely futile. To the idea of perceiving oneness is futile from the very beginning. So every moment it's futile. There's never been the slightest bit of momentum towards succeeding at that. Never. Never will be. But to keep this whimsical notion going, there's the belief that there's momentum. They're making progress and there's momentum towards success. So can that turn around, you know, in a short time here? There's really no rational basis to assume that, really. You can all say, well, it'd just be an incredible miracle. Yeah, but actually, miracles only seem to be miracles. They actually are grounded in changes and adjustments that we make to our belief systems. And that takes a bit of time and effort. It takes effort to drop effort. You know, it takes, because of the continuity problem, it takes time to drop time. It takes momentum towards dropping momentum. You know, all of this stuff, it's paradoxical stuff. It takes an effort to drop effort. It does. So because of the continuity fear, I cannot see a scenario where it's going to, you know, it's going to happen. I cannot see such a scenario. The laws, the activist judiciary now, the legal system is so incredibly activist. They want to be the ones who you know, shape and form the momentum of this great effort to perceive oneness, which is ultimately the effort to be greater than God. If we could perceive, if oneness can be perceived, it means there's a perceiver outside of oneness. That's a subject that is objectifying oneness. So oneness would not be oneness. It would not be everywhereness. So the judiciary wants to shape and mold, and so everything is so, has gotten derailed off of the institutions of repentance. Religious institutions are supposed to stand for repentance, and to some extent they do. So we've gotten off the tracks of that towards a unrepentant, spiritually prideful ideology, secular, humanist, materialistic, socialist, communist, all this stuff has to do with human progress. Instead of salvation through grace, meaning you don't need to do anything. You don't achieve happiness. Happiness is already the case. Not something that is achieved. Perception, we're trying to achieve perception of happiness, perception of oneness. It's impossible. There's nothing outside of happiness to achieve it. Happiness is everywhere. Everywhere is everywhere. There's nothing to achieve it. So the whole notion of achievement is what stands in the way. So we have this world ideology of achievement now. Like a cancer, like an extreme cancer. And it's, you know, it's probably very terminal, a cancer. I just read today that, you know, someone, this is very common, you come across this ideology now, it's more and more coming forth, says, I think that what we need is for the older generation to die off. Everyone from the older generation needs to just die. That's now, you know, part of the thinking of this achievement-oriented mindset of the world. Now, the older generation meaning what? You know, people who might still have some thoughts of repentance, see? That maybe achievement isn't the end-all of everything, really. Maybe a desire to maintain, you know, a culture of repentance at some level. They say, you know, the real remedy, they're saying now the real remedy is for the older generation to just die, which, as I pointed out, look out for that. Look out for that. That is definitely on their bucket list. Definitely on their bucket list. Some of the older people, afraid of that, are siding with the younger generation, saying, hey, yeah, that's a great idea. I'll help out with that, trying to save their own skin, as it were. But I have seen such a scenario as a possibility. It's in the intent of the egomaniacs to wipe out the mood of repentance because they feel that's detracting from their grandiosity, right? If you have people who are repentant, they're not turning to any person to save them. They're already saved. They're turning to the mood of repentance to save them, actually, so they can absorb the great good news that everything is already perfect. Perfection is already perfect. Doesn't need to be achieved. Doesn't need to be perceived. Nothing needs to be perceived. We don't need perception. So the grandiosity of the egomaniacs, they can't stand that. They want to be seen as they're the ones who are achieving, and they're the ones who are leading to success, to achievement that will succeed. And, you know, and so they don't want the mood of repentance in the world. It detracts from their grandiosity, as it were. You know, when people said Christ was the way back in Roman times, the Roman emperors were so offended by that. They said, who is this Christ? He just meekly died on a cross. You know, what is that? And, he's not a warrior. He didn't triumph. He didn't achieve anything. What did he achieve? You know, they'd say. How can you possibly be following this very subdued person? Supremely subdued, quiet, subdued, peaceful, turn the other cheek, love your enemies. They said, that's nuts. This is not a person of accomplishment. This is not somebody leading the evolution of consciousness on this planet, the evolution of perception, helping us inspire and motivate us to be stronger and more intensely thinking and developing our abilities to perceive, and you know, all these. And he's not doing that at all. So they were very, their grandiosity was extremely offended by that. And hence there was this tremendous persecution of the early Christians, horrible persecutions, waves of massive persecutions. Though those who follow the mood of repentance have been persecuted throughout history. Now, I don't think that's a good idea at all. I think it would be much better served if they were not persecuted, even if they need to part ways from the egomaniacs. You know, if all the repentant people of the planet left the planet today, you know, would the news even report it, is the question. Would the news even report it? They probably just ignored it, to tell you the truth. To tell you the truth, what would probably happen is that it would just be swept under the rug. If maybe, like, I don't know, if I say a billion people suddenly just vanish from this planet right now, the remaining 6 billion would just shrug their shoulders and just say, well, you know, whatever. I guess those are the failures. Those are the failures. Those are the ones that failed, and I didn't fail, so I'm happy, and let's keep achieving here. Let's get after it here. We got a great opportunity. Now, they'll probably celebrate and say, well, wow, this is great. Finally, we got rid of those terrible, terrible laggards, and now we can really get after it. Now we can really turn this world into what we want it to be. Now we can really succeed. Now the golden age has arrived. Yeah, they'll look at it that way. They'll mark it down as like the greatest thing that ever happened, or something like that. Yeah, that's the truth. So they won't miss us when we're gone, really. But as they say, you don't realize what you've lost until they're gone. It's gone. You don't realize what you have until they're gone. But their pride will not allow them to see it that way. In fact, their pride is such that they... A lot of forgetting. They'll have to bury it and bury it and bury it and bury it and bury it until they can finally forget all about it, and they don't want to be reminded of their, you know, their pride. So it will not, if such a thing happened, it will not be something like thinking like the way it will happen would be a little different than we expect, really. The world really doesn't care. Say, you know, oh, good riddance. They'll say, good riddance, don't come back, is what they'll say. And you know, you think, wow, won't this wake them up? No, not at all, not at all. Not at all. If we expect that to wake the world up, we're deluded. So this is very humbling, you know. It's very humbling to see just how blind pride really is. Very humbling. Kind of scary, actually. So I think we kind of want help from the world to react and say, wow, you know, to reassure us that pride is not such a, you know, cannot blind us so terribly. Because when we see how bad pride can blind us, that shocks us, you know. It shocks us and we say, wow, I might really have severe continuity problem, really bad. Well, we do. So that's why I say embrace your continuity problem. Say, yeah, I do have a really severe continuity problem, but I know that if I just work at it, I'm going to be able to diminish it to a tremendous extent. That's what the Holy Spirit told me when I had a moment of awakening, and then I slipped back into it because of the collective, you know, pride of the planet. It seemed like I said, wow, you know, I can't expand this into the world, this realization. Then I realized that just how strong the continuity fear is, just so strong. And the Holy Spirit said, I had awareness. He said, look, just work at this, work at it. You can work at it and you can diminish all this, tremendously diminish the fear, and you will eventually, you'll get it. And I understood that. I understood it. It's just a matter of getting to work. That's all it is. The work to realize we don't need to work at it is the work. The progress, which brings us to the realization that no progress is needed. What progress does oneness need in to realize oneness? Everything already is one. What progress is needed for that to be so? What needs to see this as so? Is already so. What was there something needs to doesn't see it and it needs to see it? Something. What's that? No, there isn't. It's already. What is already so doesn't need to be seen to be so. It already is so. The seeing is like saying, wait a minute. I don't see it yet. You know, it still is so. Still is so. That's time, isn't it? There's no place where it is not so. So we're saying, wait, I need to get to the place where it isn't so, so I can see that it is so. It's nonsense. So, it's kind of demoralizing when people just simply, they don't even care that if you're not here. It doesn't matter. That's how deep their continuity issue is, how severe it is, and unacknowledged it is. But that's what we're looking at right now. I don't believe at all if repentant people were to leave this planet for some other dwelling place, I don't think the world would shed a tear at all over that. They wouldn't stop it. Would they stop and have a moment of repentance and say, whoa, what just happened here? I think everyone would pretty much probably go to a movie and go see some lizard, you know, lizard movie or something, and they get their attention right off of it, right? Let's go watch a lizard tear a city apart. You know, that's what they do. bred in circuses. Bred in circuses. And they would not go into a mood of repentance and say, hey, you know what? Maybe we missed the boat here. Why did we miss the boat? How come? What's going on here? Would there be some deep reflection? I don't think so. The society has been trained to not be deeply reflective, to not be superficially reactive instead of deeply reflective. Now, what if there's just a movie where someone was just sat there and talked about repentance for a couple hours? Would people go see that movie? It'd be awful at the box office. Maybe nobody would go see it. Actually, there's a movie right here doing that. Actually, see, I couldn't get Hollywood to to underwrite this as a feature release throughout the world. So I'm just doing it here on YouTube. They say there ain't no money in that deal. Used to be, people loved religious movies that had some themes towards repentance and humility and all of that, absolutely. But there's been a concerted effort to change that. So that when, if there is this great rapture, great exodus off this planet, that people will just say, ah, let's go watch a monster tear a city apart. That makes us, and forget about it. Don't dwell on it. That's the past. Whatever. Idiots. Good. Better off without them. Don't even. Let's get focused back on the monster destroying a city. And of course, as those who are not in the mood of repentance, throughout the years, they keep missing their opportunities. They keep producing more and more distractions and movies, etc. Say, hey, here, let's watch this action robots blowing each other up and stuff. And so you don't become reflective. Say, maybe I'm missing the boat here. Is there something I'm not getting? Maybe I feel like I could do better in life. I feel like I'm kind of missing the boat here, right? Like, what is it that I'm, what's the deal? What's the problem? Maybe I better start doing the search for answers. Maybe I better start trying to find answers here. They don't want, egomaniacs don't want you to do that. They want you to think they have the answer for you. So you worship them, give them all your money, give them all your time, your attention, and they think, wow, I'm God. Everybody thinks I have the answer. I must have it. It's like that. So they keep producing distractions and telling you you need to listen to them. So you don't become deeply reflective. Do not miss the boat. What happens when you miss the boat? More bread and circuses. Let's televise atrocities on television, beheadings on television, terrible atrocities. Let's televise those, which they've been doing, right? Let's televise these bombs exploding, blowing up people. Let's get everyone on the news, Let's get them doing that instead of deeply reflective here. Mood of repentance. Seeing the great, awesomely great good news. Like, wow, I never did anything to life, to oneness. It's always been perfectly pristine. It remains completely pristine. It's never not been pristine. It's all perfect. Everything's perfect. Seeing that, instead of, that's what's necessary. So maybe the key to it all is to recognize and accept that most people, you won't even make a ripple in their lives, actually. I know Jesus says that people inescapably will feel your presence or something. At some level, that is true. But also, people will do everything they can to divert their attention from that. And the means are here in this world. It's custom designed, this world, to distract from the mood of repentance. It is custom designed. Now you may wonder why the Roman Catholic Church, why they, for centuries, millennia actually, tried to prevent so many different things. They all these rules, and people think, oh, it's so terrible. actually it's not. They were trying to prevent the modern culture from arising because they knew it would be the mood of distraction, distracting from the mood of repentance, where you know this custom designed, you know, flat screen theater surround sound, home theater, 1,000 channels, every movie on demand. All you have to do is say, I want to watch this movie, and boom, you're able to watch it on this big high def screen surround sound with all this great food and drugs, and working hard on making sure everyone has, you know, illegal drugs. So you can just like trip out on this, like, wow, this is incredibly distracting. This is look at all this, look at all these monsters fighting. Whatever it is, pornography, monsters fighting, following some great battle, or celebrities, or, you know, whatever it is, whatever, they have it, you know, on demand, on demand, on demand, on demand. It's all custom designed to distract you away from the shock of realizing, hey, I missed the boat. I'm missing the boat, and I really missed the boat. Make you feel, so you don't feel remorse. They say, hey, we're here to help you. But they presuppose you're gonna miss the boat and say, don't worry, we're here to help you overcome your remorse in missing the boat. And everybody says, thank you, you're my savior. I would feel so terrible in missing the boat. Well, how about not missing the boat? How about not missing the boat? What happened to that, not missing the boat? What happened to not missing the boat? How about that? See? Holy fuck, they didn't think about that. They presumed everyone missed the boat. So they want to make you feel like, hey, it's no problem. I got these monsters fighting on my screen here. This is great. I got the hero coming in. Heroes are fighting the villains. So this is very interesting. Who cares about anything else? What boat? You know, what boat? What boat? I didn't miss any boat. What boat? So this is very shocking to see this, really. Very tough. To see the depths of distraction that we can get into is very unsettling, actually. When you see how unaware people are of truth, it's very unsettling, because you realize I was there too. I have the same capacity of self-deception. I was there. It's like, wow, that's very scary. It's unsettling. I don't like to see it, really. So that's another tough part of this world, is recognizing, whoa, what a pit that is, you know, what a black hole, you know, there's this terrible black hole. Which is just an image, actually, of a black hole. It doesn't affect oneness at all. So if there were to be some big exodus, those who take the exodus would certainly want that to be a teaching lesson to those who remain behind, for sure. But it is likely not to be. So they may feel like, well, I need to stay here until it becomes a teaching lesson. I need to, you know, get their attention. So, hey, you know, wake up. It's not likely to happen. I don't see that happening. Maybe it's too late to even try. Yeah, I certainly made an effort, like starting 1997, I think it was, a huge effort to try to be relevant enough so people would realize that, hey, maybe, you know, we're missing something, or missing the boat, trying to bring that awareness, missing the boat. It didn't work. Because the more I tried, the more the media threw up these disasters, threw up, you know, the more Hollywood threw up these movies, the more, you know, concerts there were, the more drugs they designed, the more raves they you know, were going on. Just, it, you know, there's this massive inflow of distraction in this world, where people would be like, they'll pay a little attention to what you say, and say, oh, okay, they sort of feebly reach that way, and then suddenly there's a monster movie, and like, oh, wow, Grandma, look at this monster movie, you know. It's like that. It's really like that. I used the images of teachers, great teachers, etc., but people didn't really get it. They say, oh, yeah, this person's really wonderful, they're really beautiful. But what I was after is this feeling of like, hey, wait a minute. If I don't get what they got, you know, I'm really gonna miss the boat. I feel like I may miss out on a tremendous opportunity. That's what I was trying to convey to people. I mean, they could very well miss out on a huge, huge opportunity. Don't waste your life. This is very important. And it didn't sink in. It didn't sink in. People say, oh, yeah, he's really a nice, nice person, you know. Oh, I like that guy. Very, 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 very nice. Looks like a real nice, peaceful person. Okay. And back to the monster movies. But for me, I'm saying like, hey, wait a minute. I'm missing out on happiness. I'm suffering like crazy. I'm totally missing out on happiness. That's terrible. Here's an opportunity. I have an opportunity to remedy that. And I can't waste my time being distracted by this. I feel remorse. I feel repentance. I feel like, wow, I'm really blown. I'm really, you know, off track here. I need to get on track here. I need to drop the effort to find oneness, because that's where we already are. That's where everything already is. We don't need to find anything. We need to drop the effort, or else I'm going to miss the boat. And so it brings urgency into your life. Like, wow, I'm really gonna mess up here. I'm really messing up my life. Really messing it up. And that's super important, to feel like, hey, I'm really messing up my life, this opportunity. I'm messing it up. I need to just go all out emergency here to so I don't, you know, mess my life up. But now people just say, oh yeah, there's, you know, oh yeah, that reminds me of that movie actress or something. Oh yeah, that's pretty. She reminds me of that movie actress in this series. Yeah, the series is like really interesting series. Just beautiful, you know, beautiful people, wonderful. And then they relate it back to entertainment, news, entertainment, distraction, etc. These are the things that actually the church was trying to block. Trying to block the entire modern news and information monster is what they were trying to block. That's absolutely, because they knew. How do they know? Because it's happened in other planets, actually. This is what's happening here. Very common. This is what happens. And so they're trying to prevent the science and technology to make it possible for everybody to have these big flat screens in their home, their smartphones, and plugged into, you know, all this distraction constantly. That's happened before in other planets. And it came here from other planets, from extraterrestrials, who have contaminated other planets with this stuff. And the church knew all about that. There are many seers in the church, many enlightened beings, actually, who were aware of the cosmic issues more than just this planet, and they knew, hey, this stuff, we got to prevent it from to say, well, it doesn't really matter if I miss the boat, I've got plenty of entertainment here to keep me happy. And that's what happens, and that's what's happened on this planet. It's exactly what's happened. So A lot of people are going to miss the boat. That's a sad thing. Don't want to see that. I still don't know what exactly is going to happen. Really, I'm in the dark about that for some reason. Maybe it's just as well. It would probably activate my thinking too much if I knew. Because then I'd probably say, okay, now I know. Let me get everybody ready. Let me help get everybody ready. And then it costs too much activism, you know, and then I miss the boat myself. What they're doing is they're basically outlawing the mood of repentance. They're outlawing it. They're closing in on this outlawing of this. I remember in school they had to show these movies and stuff that you have to watch. Everyone has to watch. I don't want to watch this. I want to be deeply reflective. This is taking me out of my reflective mood and the recognition that I'm wasting my life and missing the boat, and I need to focus on that. No, everybody has to watch. Everybody has to watch. You got to go to the movies. You got to discuss the movies. What movie did you see? We're going to discuss this movie. Pushing, distraction on everybody. And God forbid if somebody goes to school with any iconography, of the idea of the mood of repentance, a cross, a shirt, or something, you know. God, Jesus, you know, is saying basically, hey, are you reflecting deeply about your opportunity, you know, to repent? Mood of repentance. God forbid anyone does that in school, you know, they'll take you out and shoot you, basically. They'd like to, actually. They'll expel you. Don't come back to school. You know, like that. They'll put a bag over your head. That's how freaked out they are, see? Pagan cult of secular materialism, achievement, believing, yes, we can perceive reality. Yes, we can perceive reality. That's their mantra. Yes, we can. That's their mantra. That's their mantra. That's really the mantra of self-deception. There should be no, we can't perceive oneness. No, we cannot perceive oneness. Oneness cannot be perceived. So what is perception? Nothing. No, we cannot perceive every awareness. We can experience it. We can know it. It can only be experienced. It can only be known. Right now, everywhere, right now, is the feeling. Everywhere, right now. Well, how do you feel? I feel everywhere, right now. See, this is a confession of truth. So, how often have you heard people say, "Hey, how do you feel that?" I feel everywhere, right now. Everywhere, right now. How often have you heard that? Probably never. We should greet one another with, you know, mood of repentance to you. May the mood of repentance, may you be in the mood of repentance. And another one respond, may you be in the mood of repentance as well. You know, this is how people should greet one another. May you be in the mood of repentance. And when they leave, may the mood of repentance bless all the hours of your day, you know, so when you depart, something like that. In India, namaste, namaste, peace, you know, or in others, peace be unto you. You know, the greetings of peace, may peace be unto you. Meaning the mood, may the mood of repentance, may you be in the mood of repentance always here. but that's been trivialized and pop culturized and everything. It's fading out of the picture. As they say, as soon as the older generation dies away, they think everything's going to be great. Hey, how do you feel? Everywhere right now. That's how I feel. Everywhere right now. So the world has dropped the ball. There's no question about it. It's dropped the ball. What happened was the distraction experts came to this planet. Extraterrestrials came to this planet. They're distraction experts. We invited them here. They were invited here. Out of continuity fear. Out of continuity fear. We thought, you know, let's have one last, this last call, let's have one last drink. Let's have one last binge. Let's have one last wild party of distraction. So they're invited here. And they have done their dirty deeds here of producing, custom producing all this distraction in the world. So the world cannot afford to do that. Cannot afford to, you have to say no to that. You cannot say, I'll have one last party. You have to say no. No. Enough's enough. No more. Say no to the party girls, you know. Say no more. No more party. Sorry, party girls, you're out of luck. No more. That's it. You're out of luck. Gotta say no at some point. You know, if the monsters don't distract you, then they'll have the movies of all the party girls, you know, and say, wow, girls gone wild, look at all these party girls. You know, there's this, you know, so, oh, you know. Now we gotta say, now, party's over. That party's over. Party of distraction is over. I feel everywhere right now. Everywhere right now is how I feel. Everywhere right now is how I feel. So of course, the mood of repentance, those who are responsible for the mood of repentance, You got to make sure that the party girl mentality does not get going in this world. You got to make very careful, very severely make sure that it doesn't, that does not start take root and start growing in the world. That truly brings an extreme mood of distraction in the world. Party girl models everywhere saying, look at this distraction. You need this distraction in your life. You need this distraction in your life. They're selling distraction is what they're doing. A wise institution will not allow that, will not allow human models to be selling distraction, because party girls are very good at selling distraction. That has to be, you know, outlawed. Legally cannot do that. Cannot allow a culture to develop that way. It's disastrous. Just remember that all those party girls are egomaniacs, thinking that perceiving them is your happiness. Perception is never happiness. You cannot perceive happiness. You cannot, we cannot perceive. Happiness is not perceivable. Keep that in mind. Happiness is not perceivable. Will never be perceivable. oneness will never be perceivable, cannot perceive oneness.